Evening, everybody. You quieted down very nicely in short order. My name is Tom Morgan, and I'm here to welcome you to the 2013-2014 season of lectures here at the Allworth Center for the Study of Peace and Justice. The overarching topic, as I think most of you know, is America still the indispensable nation, as Madeleine Albright says we are? Well, that's the subject that we're going to be approaching from a variety of perspectives all year. But I think one thing for sure is you are the indispensable audience. I thank you all for coming and continuing to support this lecture series, which is sponsored by, of course, the Allworth Center for the Study of Peace and Justice here at the College of St. Scholastica, funded in part by the Warner Series of the Manitou Fund, the DeWitt and Carolyn Van Ever Foundation, and by Mary C. Van Ever in memory of William Van Ever, a former trustee of the college. Additional support for the whole series has been received from the Global Awareness Fund of the Duluth Superior Area Community Foundation, the Royal D. Allworth Institute at the University of Minnesota Duluth, and from Reader Weekly of Duluth. They're also pretty indispensable sponsors, too, so I'm very appreciative of that. Before I get too far into this program, I want to promote an event we're having in a couple of weeks, which has almost nothing to do or directly with American foreign policy, but I'm looking forward to it, and there's some material out in the lobby about it. Last year, you may recall, I hope you do, that the topic for last year's lectures was global poverty, and we had, I think, four pretty good lectures, but we didn't totally cover the subject, in my judgment anyway. So we have one more lecture we're squeezing in, October 16th, and it's by Catherine Boo, who has roots here in Duluth and here at the college. And she wrote just a wonderful book, Pulitzer Prize-winning writer, called Behind the Beautiful Forevers, a great book about poverty and for me personally, added more to my understanding of the whole problem. So that's October 16th here at the Mitchell Auditorium, and now you know. One other thing that you should know is that one thing that we do every year, or at every lecture, that is we have a talkback gathering at the following week, the week following the lecture, and I hope you have flyers like this one promoting that. This lecture's talkback will be conducted by Cindy Christian, my colleague at UMD, and her biography and her credentials are in this document I think you all have. She'll be a good person to lead the discussion, and so I thank Cindy for your willingness to do that. Also, there's a sign-up sheet if you're not on the mailing list and you want to be, about further lectures in this series. That's right out in the foyer after the lecture. You'll see it there. Our speaker this evening is the Christian A. Herder, Professor of International Relations at Brandeis University, where he teaches and studies international relations, specializing in national security affairs and American foreign policy. Professor Art earned his doctorate at Harvard University, where he has held a Woodrow Wilson doctoral dissertation fellowship, and where he completed a postdoctoral fellowship with the Center for International Affairs at Harvard. Professor Art is a former member of the Secretary of Defense Long Range Planning Staff and a former dean of the Graduate School of Arts and Sciences at Brandeis. He has consulted for the Central Intelligence Agency and is a member of the editorial boards of the scholarly journals International Security, Political Science Quarterly, and Security Studies. He's lectured at numerous American universities and research institutes, as well as at U.S. military and foreign institutions. He's received grants from the Center for International Affairs at Harvard, the Council of Foreign Relations, the Guggenheim Foundation, the Ford Foundation, the United States Institute of Peace, and the Century Foundation, to name a few. Professor Art has authored, co-authored, and edited several books on grand strategy and military history in recent years, including A Grand Strategy for America, The Use of Force and Democracy, The Use of Force and Democracy and Counterterrorism, Lessons from the Past. He was the recipient of the International Studies Association Distinguished Scholar Award in 2006, and also was recently honored at Georgetown University for his lifetime contributions to American scholarship and policy on international security affairs. Professor Art lives with his wife, Suzanne, who is a retired elementary teacher and author of numerous books on ancient history for middle school readers. They have two children, David, a political science professor, a chip off the old block, and Robin, a poet. Plus, they have three granddaughters, and I just jotted down their names, Titania, 6, Letty, 2, and Matilda, 11 months. When he's not thinking about American foreign policy and grand strategy issue or spending time with his grandchildren, Professor Art likes to work out. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Professor Robert J. Art.
Thank you, Tom. Thank you very much for that kind introduction. Can you all hear me okay? For those of you, I can't see you very well, but for those of you that are sitting in the bleachers, why don't you come on down a little bit? I won't bite. And if you want to leave early, it's okay. Okay. Come on down a little bit. It's makes it for much more, nobody's going to budge. Do I have to come up and pull some people down? Please, come on down. Makes for a better experience. Well, at least I got three people to move. It's a pleasure to be here tonight. It's a real pleasure to be back in the Midwest. Being born and raised in Canton, Ohio, Football Hall of Fame, which wasn't there when I was there, it's nice to be back in the Midwest. The Midwest has a special feel and style all its own, and it's something that I feel very comfortable with. I've never been to Duluth before, and we have a beautiful city here and a beautiful area, and I hope I'll have an opportunity to come back again. I'm going to talk about a weighty subject, and I'm going to move fairly quickly because there's a lot to cover. And I will try to be as clear as I can, but this is serious stuff that I'm talking about. It involves the fate of nations in the United States. It involves the spread of WMD, of weapons of mass destruction. It involves the possibility of death and destruction. It has to do with how the United States uses its military in the world today. The United States, as my message will be, cannot afford to return to isolationism, nor should it be the world's policeman. But certainly between those two extremes of isolationism on the one hand and the world's policeman on the other, there must be a role for the United States to pursue that is sensible, that is affordable, and that will do good not only for others but for ourselves. So I want to address two central questions tonight in the time that I have. The first is, what are America's interests in the world today? That is, what goals should the United States aim for in its foreign policy? The second is, how can America's military power serve those interests, if at all? So what should we be doing in the world, and how can our military instrument be of use? It's not that the military instrument is the be-all and end-all of the instruments of statecraft, by no means. It is usually, however, the most dangerous. It costs a lot in blood and treasure, but it's also a very decisive instrument if used correctly. So my talk does not discount the other instruments of statecraft. Military force should, in general, be the last, not the first resort of statecraft. And this is not to demean diplomacy or economic measures or political acumen. It is to say, however, that the United States is the world's only superpower and will probably remain so for the next several decades. And a lot of people have been relying on us for a long time. And the question is, should they continue to rely on us? And if so, for what things? So this is what I would like to do. This is how I want to proceed to answer these two questions. First, I want to talk about the current and future international environment. Second, I want to talk about what I conceive to be America's interest in the world. And I will enumerate for you six national interests and a strategy to pursue them. And third, I want to talk about what that strategy looks like in the current era and projecting out 10 or 15 years. So to repeat, what are America's interests and how can military power help us achieve those interests? To do so, I want to look at the current environment, I want to look at America's interests, and I want to look at the strategy to achieve them. I think America's unipolar moment is over. That is when the United States had not only overweening military power, but tremendous political appeal and tremendous economic strength. Certainly that was characteristic of the 1990s. The unipolar moment begins with the breakup of the Soviet Union in December of 1991, and in my view ends with the collapse of Lehman Brothers on September 15, 2008. So during those 17 years, what did the world look like for us? First, the United States had no military peer. Second, its economy did quite well, at least during the first half of that period. Third, it fought two big wars in the Persian Gulf and three lesser ones in the Balkans and Afghanistan. And for most of this period, America's political economic model, democratic capitalism, was heralded as the best way to organize a society. The United States did pretty much during this era as to what it wanted to do, even when its actions were opposed by others. The United States was not a global hegemon. A hegemon is a country that can take on all other countries at once if necessary. There's never been a global hegemon in world history, although the Mughals came closest to it in the 16th century. But clearly the United States has been the most powerful state in the world measured in terms of both economic and military power ever since it geared up for World War II. We are a superpower, however. There's no other country in the world that can do what the United States can do, which is to field forces and fight in two theaters simultaneously and be the most important military actor in those two theaters. In fact, the United States operates in three or four theaters in the world. So that's where we're coming from. Where are we now? What does the current environment look like? First, we still have a serious fiscal situation. It's been in the making since 2002. This will constrain the resources that the United States can put into its foreign policy, and in particular, its military power. Many people don't realize, but in fact, we have solved, although in a stupid way, in my judgment, most of our deficit problem. But we've done it by dealing with discretionary spending. We were about $4 trillion in the hole, and with the various measures that Congress has passed and the President has proposed and signed, we've dealt with about $3.5 trillion or so of that problem. But we've done it by eating our seed corn. We've done it in terms of cutting discretionary program and research and development investment. We still haven't dealt with the serious underlying issues of Social Security, although that's relatively easy to fix, but particularly with Medicare. And the military is going to be increasingly squeezed in terms of its healthcare program called TRICARE, which is growing, as I understand it, even faster than the costs of Medicare. The Pentagon has been cut by about $487 billion, but that's a mythical cut because the Pentagon had proposed a budget out 5 years. The Pentagon always plans out 5 years in something called the FYDP, the five-year defense program, planned for annual real increases, that is, above inflation. This was a budget that the Pentagon proposed that Congress never accepted. Nevertheless, with sequestration and what looks to be the future, we're going to cut our military seriously. The Army's going down by about 80,000 troops. The Marines are going down about 20,000 troops. We will not be able to maintain a fast tempo of operations in addition to engaging in research and development and modernization. So we're going to have a smaller military force. And therefore, we have to think about how we more wisely use our military power in this era of austerity. Second, the current trends in the distribution of global power, it seems to me, magnify these effects of our economic troubles at home. The world today is bipolar economically. That is, there is the European Union, which almost matches the United States in GDP, gross domestic product, and certainly is about 100 million larger in terms of overall population. If the EU continues to hold together, and I think it will in one way or another, although not necessarily with the euro, or with the euro as widely used as it now is, the European Union will continue to be an important economic actor. China is coming up quickly. Measured in, by one measure, what's called purchasing power parity, the Chinese economy is roughly three-quarters or a little more of that of the United States. Measured in nominal dollars, it's about one-third. In the next decade, when we look out, China will continue to grow. At what rate is problematical? Certainly not what it's done in the last two decades at double-digit rates. But if China continues to grow at 7% per year, which is what the Communist Party is planning for in its current five-year plan, and the United States grows at 2.5% or 3%, it's not so hard to figure out that at some point they're going to catch up with us. So I see a world now that looks on the verge of being tripolar in terms of economic power. And what does that mean? That means that the global distribution of economic power is going to be less advantageous to the United States, because we will not carry the weight that we once did, or certainly that we carried in the last two decades. The third feature that I see looking out from now to the next decade or decade and a half is that the United States will likely retain its dominance in the military realm, and will do so much longer than in the economic realm. Why? Because we have an overwhelming lead. And given the time that it will take China and any other country to build up a military of global reach, is going to take many, many years. Building an aircraft carrier may be easy. Actually learning how to run one and to have airplanes take off of aircraft carriers is not a trivial exercise. Building navies is not simply expensive. Training the people to run the Navy is an acquired art, pardon the pun. However, what's clear to me is that the United States is going to face a tough challenge from China in maintaining its maritime supremacy in East Asia. If China's economy continues to grow at a rate twice that of the United States, even if no longer at double-digit rates, it's going to increasingly constrain what the United States can do not only in East Asia, but what the United States can do elsewhere. The Asia pivot that you've read about in the last year and a half is recognition of China's growing military power in East Asia. But China is the continental superpower, if you will, in East Asia. The United States is the naval or maritime superpower. China's long-term interest is to evict the United States from East Asia or to challenge, if not surpass, America's maritime military power, because this is what great powers do. All great powers have used their power in the past, and the future is no exception, the present and future is no exception in my view, to shape their international environment, be it regionally or globally, to suit their interests. So even if the Chinese economy doesn't catch up with the American economy for another decade and a half or surpass it, and even if China never achieves maritime supremacy over the United States in East Asia, nonetheless, as long as it continues to pour money into its military and to modernize it, it's going to make life more difficult for the United States in that region, which means we will have less available military power to use elsewhere, which simply underlines the fact that with challenges from abroad and greater scarcity at home, we have to be real smart in how we use our resources. Now, having enumerated those three, I don't want to paint a picture of gloom and doom for the United States. I do not believe the picture is grim. We retain considerable advantages. If you have studied just briefly the demographic picture for Europe or for China and for Japan, it looks catastrophic. For you demographers in the audience, you know you like a pyramid like this, not a flat pyramid, but one that's fairly steep, with a lot of working age people here and the retirees up here. Well, Europe and Japan and China are going to look more like this, with fewer workers and a lot of older people like me to support. The United States is quite advantaged in this regard. We are the only one of the great powers who will age less rapidly than the other, including China. This has tremendous ramifications for economic innovation, for economic competitiveness, and for disposable military manpower, literally the cannon fodder, that is, people who serve in the infantry. The United States retains a strong entrepreneurial spirit. Its populace works hard. It has a significant lead in most of the technologies of the future. It still retains a considerable share of the world's manufacturing base. Moreover, it's not clear that China will not actually grow old before it grows rich, which is a great concern among Chinese planners. China may fall into what is called the middle income trap. That is, it may not successfully challenge the United States in terms of its per capita GDP. Its overall GDP may be that of the United States, but since it has four times as many people, it will be one quarter as rich as the United States. So when I look out over the next 10 years, I see that the United States will remain the world's most powerful state, but its relative edge is going to wane to some degree. Global power is going to become less concentrated, and as a consequence, the United States is going to have less freedom of maneuver than it did during this unipolar era when its dominance in all areas was just overwhelming. So I don't know how successful the United States is going to be in fixing its economic and fiscal ills. I don't know how powerful other states are ultimately going to become, but we have some tough problems at home, and other countries are going to grow stronger, and it seems to me with those two trends in mind, prudence dictates some adjustment in America's international ambitions. So that leads me to my second topic. That is, what should America's interests be? And what kind of strategy should serve them? About 20 years ago, I laid out in an article and subsequently in a book that was published 10 years ago, a strategy called selective engagement. Engagement meant that the United States should not pursue an isolationist foreign policy. Selective meant it should be intelligent in what it chooses to do, because it can't do everything. This strategy had three components. First, it said there were six things that it was important for the United States to do and tried to rank order them. Second, it argued that a forward defense posture was best designed to realize these interests. And third, that concluded after the Cold War was over that the United States should not retreat into isolationism, or what is today called in my profession, offshore balancing. What does forward defense posture mean? It means we have allies abroad, we have bases abroad, we have forces that are either afloat or ashore. It means that the United States has not gotten rid of all of its alliances and brought all of its troops home. A genuine isolationist policy, as opposed to a policy of restraint, is one that says the rest of the world can go to hell, forgive me, Lord, but it will not affect the United States. Why? Because we are very powerful. We are very secure. There are two ocean moats between us and everybody else. We are far removed from the other centers of power. We are blessed by geography and by abundance of natural resources. I don't believe that an isolationist posture in which the United States gets rid of all of its alliances, in which the United States brings all of its troops home, and in which the United States basically doesn't use its military instrument unless it is attacked, or unless it looks like a great Eurasian power is on the verge of dominating either Eastern Eurasia or Western Eurasia, that is East Asia or Western and Central Europe. So I looked out and said 20 years ago, what should we do? And I concluded that given what I thought we should do, we needed to have a forward defense posture. We needed to retain allies, we needed to retain bases abroad. And third, we needed to have an activist international global leadership and not retreat into isolationism or offshore balancing. So let me elaborate this a little bit more. First, what are the six interests that I laid out? It's kind of like motherhood and apple pie that I'm going to tell you now, because I think that most of this will be straightforward to you, and it should be. The question is how to achieve these interests. For those of you who are Star Trek fans, and I mean the real Star Trek, the first Star Trek, which I've seen many, many times, some of which are incredibly stupid, but some of which are really intelligent, particularly the one on computer war. The first and prime directive of any grand strategy is to protect the homeland from attack. Second interest for the United States is to keep a deep peace among the Eurasian great powers, or to keep the peace and deepen it if possible. Third interest of the United States is to preserve assured access to stable supplies of oil, even in spite of shale oil and fracking. Fourth interest of the United States is to preserve an open international economic order. The fifth is to spread democracy and the rule of law and prevent mass murders and civil wars, which has occurred in Syria today. And the sixth, to avert severe climate change. Now, what do each one of these interests require? Everybody at a certain level is in favor of these interests. The first goal, protecting the homeland from defense, means that the United States, first and foremost, has to prevent the spread of weapons of mass destruction. First and foremost, nuclear weapons. Secondarily, biological weapons. Nuclear spread is the immediate threat. The bio spread, bioweapons, is down the road about 10, 15 years and is really scary. In order to prevent the spread of weapons of mass destruction, in order to protect the United States homeland from attack, we need first and foremost to prevent the spread of weapons of mass destruction. I'm not frankly worried about hostile states or what it's been called in the past, rogue states or crazy states that acquire nuclear weapons. If Iran acquires nuclear weapons, I don't get too exercised about it, but I don't live in Israel. But I don't think the Israelis should either, because nuclear deterrence works. Nuclear deterrence has a way of making crazy people rational. If you know that a wrong step can lead to the incineration of yourself and your family and your countrymen, it provides a certain dose of reality. What I worry about is a non-state actor of an Al-Qaeda variety either buying, stealing, or being sold either fissile material or particularly a nuclear weapon. That is the existential threat to the United States today. Fortunately, the threat today is small, but an intelligent grand strategy tries to keep it small. And military power is not the only mechanism, by the way, to keep this eventuality from happening. My view is very, very simple. The more countries that acquire nuclear weapons, the greater is the likelihood that non-state actors could get their hands on them. You should be worried about Pakistan. The Pakistanis tell us that their command and control is really good. Well, when you see the governor of a state in Pakistan being murdered by one of his own bodyguards because he is defending the right of Christians in his country, it makes you wonder how secure command and control in Pakistan is. The Pakistanis' greatest concern is if something happens to Pakistan and it looks like it's breaking up, that the Americans know where all the nuclear weapons are and will come in and get them. So they don't tell us things fully that we would like to know. Maybe this is a simplistic view. I don't think it's simplistic. I think it's simple logic. You increase the chances of non-state acquisition of nuclear weapons if, in fact, more states have them. This has very severe and important consequences for the kind of foreign policy that the United States needs to follow, which I will get to in just a minute. But that is the existential threat. There's no country that can touch us conventionally. There's no country that can hurt us conventionally. We don't lie awake at night worrying about whether Mexico or Canada is going to attack the United States because we are surrounded by oceans and very weak powers. We are very blessed in that way. It's the explosion of a nuclear weapon in an American city or in several American cities by a non-state actor that remains the existential threat to protect this homeland. The second goal, Eurasian peace, means that the United States should retain its two central alliances at either end of Eurasia, the NATO alliance which now has, I believe, 27 members, and the U.S.-Japan alliance. That latter alliance is the keystone of America's position in East Asia. The third goal, secure access to oil supplies, requires that the United States act in ways that would prevent any state, either from within the region or from without, from acquiring hegemony over Persian Gulf oil supplies. Now, why do I say this? Well, first of all, the United States is going to be less dependent on Persian Gulf supplies because of the fracking revolution in the United States. And China may be well positioned, as will Europe or Germany, and certainly the Russians. But the problem is that demand for oil is increasing dramatically. It's probably going to double in the next 20 or 30 years at current projected consumption rates if they hold up. So while the United States may be less dependent on oil, Persian Gulf oil, because of the fracking revolution, the problem is the rest of the world is still very dependent on it and will be so until we find more intelligent fuel for our cars and better ways to generate electricity, which we are now working on, but we're not there yet. So Persian Gulf oil supplies are still important to the health and vitality of the global economy, even if the United States in the next 5 to 7 years will not be dependent on Persian Gulf oil. But our economic health depends in part upon the economic health of other countries in the world. The three biggest exporters in the world are China, Germany, and the United States. It's usually China, the United States, and Germany. So we have an interest in other countries buying our goods. Poor countries don't buy your goods. It's well-to-do countries that buy your goods. So as an export powerhouse, the United States has to care about the economic health of other countries. If it has to care about the economic health of other countries, it has to worry about their access to oil supplies. And where is the biggest pot of oil that is the cheapest to take out of the ground? It is still the Persian Gulf. Once they tally up the figures of what shale oil looks like, until then, the Persian Gulf has 2/3 of the world's proven oil reserves. The fourth goal, an open international economic order, requires that the United States maintain its commitment to economic openness and uses its military power to preserve that stability. Many people forget that a market doesn't work unless it's embedded in a certain kind of political order. If there are not property rights, for example, it is hard to conduct business. Go talk to anybody that tried to do business in Russia in the 1990s, or talk to American businessmen today about what it's like to deal in China and the kind of payoffs you have to make and the rampant corruption. The great English historian E.H. Carr made a very famous statement. He said, "All economic orders presuppose a political order." If that's true for domestic politics, isn't it also true for international politics? Don't you need a stable international political order for commerce and trade and investment flows to flourish? And who has been the provider of that stable order? In large part, the United States, first and foremost with its Navy. The fifth goal, spreading the rule of law and spreading democracy, the best way to do this is not by intervening in a country, as we did in Iraq, and try to create a government by force. We've been there and tried that. It actually worked in a couple of countries. It worked in Germany and Japan. Sure, if you're going to bomb the hell out of a country and fight a total war against it and kill between 1 and 2% of its population, respectively, Germany and Japan, Japan and Germany, if you're going to occupy the country for 45 years, pour in a huge amount of money, write its constitution, throw in jail anybody that violates it, you ought to be able to democratize a country after 40 or 50 years if you put in those kind of resources. But nation building is a long, drawn-out process. In my view, Iraq is falling apart. The Sunnis and the Shias are at it again, and Al-Qaeda in Iraq is resurrected, and it's now spread to Syria. So I believe in the spread of democracy and the rule of law for all kinds of reasons. States that are democratic are less likely to engage in mass murder. States that are democratic are more likely to do well economically, although not exclusively due to democracies. States which are democracies and don't engage in mass murder of their citizens require less intervention by the international community. But this is the long slog. This is a marathon. It's not done by forceful military intervention. The record is a sad one over the last 100 years of intervention with military force to create democracies. It doesn't succeed very often. More often than not, it fails. The sixth goal, averting severe climate change, requires that the world first cut and then stabilize the emissions of its CO2. We're not doing very well. If you have read the latest report by the the IPCC, the International Panel on Climate Change, it's going to take heroic efforts to keep the Earth's temperature by the end of the 21st century from rising above 2 degrees centigrade. And what climatologists are concerned about is kicking the Earth's orbit into another pattern that will be self-reinforcing. We will get into a vicious cycle in which warming creates even more warming, and the Earth will become into a new state of being that will not be that hospitable to our species. Okay, so that's what I think we should do in the world. We need to stop the spread of nuclear weapons to states and non-state actors. We need to preserve access to oil supplies. We need to keep as deep a peace among the Eurasian great powers as we can, because when they fight big wars, other countries like us are inevitably dragged in. We need an open economic order, because that generates wealth, and wealth creates middle classes, and middle classes are good for democracy. And we need to avert climate change. How can a forward defense posture help these interests? Well, think about it for a moment. Many people don't understand that America's alliances are a method of preventing the spread of nuclear weapons. We extend our nuclear umbrella over many countries that could acquire nuclear weapons if they so chose. For example, the Japanese. Well, you might come back to me and say the Japanese have an understandable nuclear allergy. I will come back to you and say that if you were in Japan 10 or 15 years ago and you talked about Japan acquiring nuclear weapons, you were viewed as a right-wing nut in Japan. In the last 10 or 15 years, you are no longer viewed as a right-wing nut. You are viewed as a person who seriously considers, if we can no longer rely on the Americans and we're facing a nuclear-armed China, will this reduce our autonomy? Forget about the fact that China's going to shoot a bomb and blow up Tokyo. That's not the scenario you worry about. It's that you worry if you cannot deter them, that somehow you will be at a disadvantage in a political crisis. It's not about the use of nuclear weapons per se. It's about the perceived political advantages that you can get by playing games of chicken, which our current president and Congress are now engaged in. Who's going to fold first? Well, you know, if you've got a strong hand, you're not going to fold first. Having a strong hand when your adversary is armed with nuclear weapons and you are bereft of them means that you are at a disadvantage. The alliance that the United States has with Japan, was viewed by the Japanese after the Cold War, when they reassessed their situation and said, our major enemy is now gone. China has not yet risen. What should we do? And their conclusion in the mid-1990s, after an exhaustive analysis, was what? It was, as long as we can rely on the American nuclear guarantee, we do not need nuclear weapons. So, extending from that conclusion, if they can no longer rely on the American nuclear guarantee, for example, our alliances and posture are viewed as no longer credible, or we simply say to the Japanese, we're out of here. We've been here since 1945. We've carried your water for you. It's time that you start carrying your own buckets of water. And we're pulling our troops out and we're ending the U.S.-Japan alliance. What are going to be the consequences in the political debate in Japan? It's going to strengthen those people that say, we now need to provide for our own political autonomy. We need to develop nuclear weapons. As you know, there's no great love lost between the South Koreans and the Japanese. What will the South Koreans then do? Turn to the Middle East. If Iran actually acquires nuclear weapons, or has a capability to judge by its neighbors to be very close, even though they have signed agreements and even though they have agreed not to acquire them, what's the United States going to have to do? The Saudi Arabian royal family is on record of saying, with no equivocation, maybe it's a bluff, but with no equivocation, if Iran gets nuclear weapons, so will we. That's almost an exact paraphrase of what they said. No, it is not a paraphrase. It's almost I believe it's the exact words. It was stated by one of the crown prince. I can't remember his name right now. So America's alliances, extension of nuclear umbrella, are a way to convince other people whom we don't want to acquire nuclear weapons. Remember, more states that get them, even if they're our friends, the greater is the likelihood of other states getting them. If we're not going to protect other people, they're going to look around for their own means of protection. And some of them are probably going to decide to go nuclear. And then we worry about what are called cascade effects, about other countries in the region for their own purposes acquiring nuclear weapons vis-a-vis their regional rivals. So if Iran goes nuclear, the United States is going to extend its nuclear umbrella over Saudi Arabia and the other Persian Gulf sheikdoms. And Secretary of State Clinton, when she was in office, basically said that, and we've already been talking with them. So there's a direct correlation between an American alliance, which is made credible by an American forward defense posture, and the goal of preventing the spread of nuclear weapons. Imagine if we retreat into isolationism. Imagine if we bring all of our troops home. Imagine if we say these alliances are no longer valid. What would you do if you were a Japanese decision maker, or if you were a leader in Saudi Arabia? The Israelis are understandably concerned, and they have nuclear weapons. So what we need to do with a forward defense posture is first and foremost protect our own security by protecting others. So according to this perverse logic, we have to worry about non-state acquisition, which means that we have to worry about more states acquiring nuclear weapons, which means that we have to take measures to prevent more states from acquiring nuclear weapons, which means ultimately that we should protect some states that can easily acquire nuclear weapons if they so choose. Japanese have tons of plutonium sitting around. It probably take them 6 months to a year to put together a bomb. I suspect less. Persian Gulf, protection of access to Persian Gulf oil. Who's going to do it? The mighty British Royal Navy? The mighty French Navy? They now share between the two of them one aircraft carrier. There is no other country, absent American participation, that has the military power projection and naval power to prevent the Straits of Hormuz, for starters, from being blocked. It's American military power that helps preserve access to Persian Gulf oil. I'm not saying that this is the way it should be. I'm saying this is the way it is now. And given funding scenarios for the Europeans and the Japanese, it doesn't look great in terms of their spending significant sums to do this on their own. Perhaps there are more creative solutions that I'm not thinking about. Keeping a deep peace among the Eurasian great powers, why is a forward defense posture important for that? Well, let's go back to the Japan example again. What's the purpose of America's alliances? It's to deter adversaries from doing bad things, and it's to reassure allies that they will be taken care of. It's a combination of deterrence and reassurance. Take the United States out of these areas, and what's going to happen? You're going to see regional jockeying. You're going to see regional arms races. You're going to see regional power balancing. You'll probably see the spread of more weapons of mass destruction, which is not a good thing for us as well as for others. So perversely, by protecting others, we are, in the last analysis, as I see it, protecting ourselves. Now, this is not an argument, as I will make clear near the end, that we should be doing everything. No, we have to pool our fair share. And what that fair share is varies according to areas. I've already talked about spreading democracy. It's the indirect approach. It's pacifying key regions so that trade can occur, so that middle classes can grow. We're already seeing this in China today. China has politically liberalized. If you go ask a 40-year-old Chinese person what it was like in 1990, what it's like now, there's so much more political space. Yes, it's not a democracy. Yes, if you talk against the government, you're thrown in jail. Yes, it's a corrupt and arbitrary system, but there's a lot more political space and political liberalization. Political liberalization is not democracy. But I hope China is on the same path that was the case for Korea and for Taiwan. Those, remember, were military dictatorships basically for a long period of time. They became rich through trade, through the protection provided by the United States so that they could trade. They grew middle classes, and what happened? They become vibrant democracies. In the case of South Korea, maybe too vibrant, but vibrant democracies nonetheless. What's the relationship between an American forward defense posture and averting climate change? Well, this is an indirect one, but just because it's indirect doesn't mean that there's no relation. If the United States, by projecting its power to three key regions, to Europe, to the Persian Gulf, and to East Asia, can help keep those regions from war and can pacify those regions and make certain they're not simply war, but intense security competitions. By that, I mean countries spend more and more on arms. Less money on arms with an American presence hopefully means more money for other important things, like technologies to wean us from fossil fuels. So a more stable world to me is a world, a less warlike world to me is a world in which resources can be allocated to interests other than to goals that are more amenable to preserving our climate. So when I look around, I say, well, if we're going to have alliances, we need in-theater alliances. Let me tell you a little story. During the Cuban Missile Crisis, the United States made a secret deal proposed to Khrushchev. You take your missiles out of Cuba, and we'll take ours out of Turkey. At that time, we had Jupiter missiles in Turkey. Some of you are old enough probably to remember that. I know I am. What were these Jupiter missiles? They were liquid-fueled above-ground missiles that you could basically disable with a rifle bullet. We had basically decided a year before the Cuban Missile Crisis to get rid of them because they were obsolete. Why? Because we had this shiny new submarine-launched missile in the Polaris submarines steaming around the Mediterranean. And we said to the Turks a year before the Cuban Missile Crisis, we're going to take these Jupiter missiles out. They're no good. We've got these great submarines. They're going to protect you better. You know what the Turks said? Said, we can't see those submarines. They're not based on our land. We can't see them. They're invisible. How are they going to deter the Russians? If we can't even see them, why are they going to believe you? What is the point of that simple example? It's that an in-theater presence of American forces is necessary for the credibility of American military and alliance guarantees. Now, we can't be everywhere in every country, but we need to be in these key regions. And being in these key regions means we either have land bases, which unfortunately are becoming much more vulnerable to ballistic missile attack by adversaries, especially China, or we need forces afloat, or we need the ability to quickly flush forces to these areas. So an in-theater presence is important. All right, so as I envision it, selective engagement as a strategy that seeks to shape events in three key regions by projecting American military power into those regions rather than simply reacting to adverse events after they have occurred. Shaping the international environment in ways that are conducive to peace in those regions and in ways that have indirect benefits as to what goes on within countries, it seems to me, is a more intelligent approach than vacating those regions and allowing things to go south and then having to come back in and pick up the pieces. But I want to emphasize that shaping doesn't mean control. Most of the hard work in these countries that are having difficulties have to be done by the locals. They have the knowledge, and if they don't care more than we care, why should we care? They have to pull their weight. What we can do is provide a congenial international environment so that they can do the kind of work that we all want them to do. Hegemons control. Superpowers, if they're successful, only shape. And so selective engagement is a shaping strategy through the projection of American military power and the political and economic influence that goes with it. Now, how about selective engagement today? If what I prescribed for the 20 years ago maybe worked for 10 or 15, is it still relevant today? Well, sadly, I think we're going to have to trim our sails. I don't think we should give up these goals, but the major adaptation in American grand strategy, and something I argued 20 years ago we shouldn't do, but that we did do with the Iraq War, is to avoid forceful military exercises in democracy promotion and state building. There's more charity out there than the world is willing to do, and certainly that the United States has resources to do. I think it's a fool's errand to go in and forcefully transform countries. Now, I'm not going to talk about Syria now, but I hope somebody will ask me a question about what we should do in Syria, because there are ways for the United States to intervene without putting troops on the ground. There is a choice between doing nothing and doing everything, or at least I think that there is a choice. So we should avoid forceful military exercises in democracy promotion and state building. That enterprise does not have a stellar track record, and frankly, in the last 15 years, we don't have a stellar track record in that regard. So what should we do? We should concentrate on those things which are not only in our interest, but in the interest of others. We should be one of the main providers, but not the only provider, of global collective goods. This is the area where the United States can do the best for itself and for others, and this is the area in which what we want to do for ourselves is also in large part to the benefit of others. For those of you that know anything about collective goods theory, you know that the theory says that if a weighty actor doesn't provide collective goods or contribute to collective goods, like averting climate change, it's going to be awful hard for anybody else to go along and do it. The most powerful actor in any realm has a great influence by whether that actor decides to contribute or not contribute to what the other actors do. The collective goods that I'm going to enumerate in just a moment are things where the United States carries a lot of weight. They are things that other countries are interested in having provided. Many of them have free rode off of the United States for too long. They should contribute more, but because they contribute more doesn't mean that we should not contribute at all. Because if the weightiest actor in the world doesn't do things which are in its interest and the world's interest, why are other countries going to go along? Why should the developing nations institute severe climate control measures not relying on fossil fuels if the United States is not prepared to do it? We are the ones, along with several other countries, that have created the problem. The future is going to be created by the developing countries, but we're the ones that created the problem. Through the burning of fossil fuels, through our early industrialization and our economic might. So to advance its interests in this new era, the United States should avoid costly boots-on-the-ground military interventions designed to spread democracy, because we can't afford it, and it doesn't work very well. And by the way, pardon my language, it tees a lot of people off. We should keep our eye on the central issues, and what are they? First, prevent the spread of nuclear weapons. Second, keep Eurasia at deep peace. Third, preserve two elements of a stable, open international economic order: freedom of the seas and assured access to Persian Gulf oil, and containing, if not also destroying, Al-Qaeda or any other group that plans terrorist actions against the U.S. homeland. I've already talked about the first, preventing the spread of nuclear weapons. And I hope you see the direct link between America's provision of security and stability to a region and the lessening of the desire by actors, not the elimination, but the lessening of the desire by actors to acquire their own nuclear weapons. Keeping the deep peace in Europe, the United States and East Asia, and to the extent that we can in the Persian Gulf, that is, if we don't end up with war with Iran. What I call the peacetime deterrence reassurance function of the United States currently takes about 175,000 troops. This will be something around 10%, 8 to 10% of the total size of the American military, which about a year and a half ago weighed in at I think 1.5 million. This regional peace mission, the stationing of about 80,000 troops in East Asia, both ashore and afloat, about 80,000 in Europe, which is useful for power projection into the Middle East, and about 5,500 in the Persian Gulf, is for the purpose of peacetime reassurance and maintenance, to shape political events in those regions, to deter attacks on U.S. allies, to reassure key regional actors, to enhance regional security cooperation, to jointly train. If war should become necessary in those regions, this peacetime power projection, reassurance, deterrence function facilitates war waging, it's late, through the advantages of joint training in theater bases and the like. So I don't think that that's terribly expensive. It's about 8 to 10%. I mean, we're talking, of course, billions, but in terms of the Pentagon budget, it's not expensive. It probably amounts to around 50 or 55 billion, which in Pentagon parlance is small change. That may be too much for us to bear, in which case we should draw down our troops even more in Europe. We need to continue to reassure our European allies. We need a residual protection against any, and they want a residual protection against any resurgence of a Russia that goes bad, which is not, I think, in the foreseeable future. Russia is still a military basket case, except for its nuclear weapons forces. We can probably draw down our troops below the 73,000 that we're programmed to have. We're going to take out two army brigades out of Europe, about 7,000 troops. We can probably go lower to cut the costs. But when you look at the potential benefits, which admittedly are hard to cost out on the one hand, and look at the costs on the other, is somewhere between 8 and 10% of the defense budget for this forward power projection posture, too much to pay given the benefits that I at least see. How about the third, maintaining freedom of the seas? I've talked about assured access to Persian Gulf oil. I've made the point that shale oil discoveries will not change the dependence of the world for a couple of decades on Persian Gulf oil. And that directly affects us, even though we don't get the oil. Freedom of the seas is an important issue. 90% of the world's commerce, 2/3 of the petroleum, travels by sea. Somewhere between 10 and million of these big cargo containers come into the United States every year by ship. We are the world's second largest importer and exporter, which consumes approximately 22% of our GDP. The seaborne sector is large and is growing. The United States Navy has performed the mission of freedom of the seas. Once you get past the United States Navy, there's not a lot to look at out there. Okay? So this is an important collective good that not only benefits us, but benefits others. Access to Persian Gulf oil is an important collective good. Preventing the spread of nuclear weapons is an important collective good. Preventing wars in these three regions is an important collective good. So too, I would argue, is Al-Qaeda, the fourth collective good, or bad, put it whatever way you want, that is important for the United States to deal with. Al-Qaeda is down, but it is by no means out. Central Al-Qaeda, that is, those people still in the northwestern frontier provinces of Pakistan or maybe over in the border region in Afghanistan, they're down. But Al-Qaeda by no means is out. Al-Qaeda has been given a new lease on life from the Arab Spring. Al-Qaeda has resurrected itself in Iraq. Al-Qaeda has spread to Syria in the form of ISIS, the Islamic State of Iraq and Syria. Al-Qaeda in the Arabian Peninsula, AQAP, is a serious threat. Al-Qaeda has now moved and affiliates into the Mali and the Sahel. The Shabab in Somalia have ties with Al-Qaeda. What does Al-Qaeda want? When you figure out what to do with Al-Qaeda, you have to ask, what does Al-Qaeda want, and how much of an away game, if I can use a baseball analogy, does the United States need to play? And with this, I'm about done. Al-Qaeda's central goal has always been the same, to evict the West from Muslim lands, all Muslim lands, so that it can topple Muslim regimes that it thinks are corrupt and that are hostile to its vision of the good Muslim society. Their goal is to recreate, in my view, the caliphate of the 8th and 9th centuries. They chose to go after us because of our central role in propping up these regimes. And we found ourselves caught in a Muslim civil war or insurgency. The question to ask is this: if we removed all of our combat forces from Arab and Muslim lands and were out of Afghanistan, hopefully soon or almost all the way out, and we get our small number of troops out of the Middle East, would that stop Al-Qaeda from attacking Americans abroad or planning attacks against the U.S. homeland? Now, nobody knows the answer to that question. But Al-Qaeda is not simply interested in American military presence. They're interested in the security assistance we give, the economic aid we give, the intelligence cooperation that we have. Are we going to end all of that with all of our allies? I want to read you a quote by Adam Gadan, who's a senior operative spokesman and media advisor for Al-Qaeda. And this was passed on to me by somebody who follows terrorist websites carefully. I'm sure the NSA knows about her. This is a statement made on June the 20th, 2010. This is what Al-Qaeda is demanding, according to this senior operative. First, you must pull every last one of your soldiers, spies, security advisors, trainers, attachés, contractors, robots, drones, and all other American personnel, ships, and aircraft out of every Muslim land from Afghanistan to Zanzibar. Second, you must end all support, both moral and material, to Israel, and bar your citizens from traveling to occupied Palestine or settling there. And you must impose a blanket ban on American trade with a Zionist regime and investment in it. Third, you must stop all support and aid, be it military, political, or economic, or otherwise, to the hated regimes of the Muslim world. This includes the so-called development aid. Fourth, you must cease all interference in the region, society, politics, economy, and government of the Islamic world. Fifth, you must also put an end to all forms of American and American-sponsored interference in the educational curriculum and information media of the Muslim world. And sixth, you must free all Muslim captives from your prisons, detention facilities, and concentration camps, regardless of whether they have been recipients of what you call a fair trial or not. In conclusion, your refusal to release our prisoners or your failure to meet any of our other legitimate demands will mean the continuation of our just struggle against your tyranny. Now, that's a pretty extensive set of demands. If it's even a close approximation to what Al-Qaeda Central and its local affiliates or regional affiliates want, this is a war to the death. It's us or them, and it's as simple as that. Now, you don't end Al-Qaeda simply by killing everybody. Al-Qaeda's probably replaced its core leadership four times over already. We keep killing them, and then middle managers rise to the top. That doesn't mean that we should stop killing them, but it means that you have to deal with the root causes of the appeal of Al-Qaeda. And that is a political problem. But there's a role for military forces, and it's a role primarily for special operations forces. We don't need to invade countries and topple regimes in order to deal with Al-Qaeda. Most governments don't like Al-Qaeda for obvious reasons. Al-Qaeda wants to overthrow them. Most Muslims do not resonate with Al-Qaeda, certainly if you look at Arab public opinion polls, because Al-Qaeda has killed mainly Muslims, not non-Muslims. So the battle against Al-Qaeda, unfortunately, is not over. And it means that we still need to play some kind of an away game in order to deal with Al-Qaeda. Part of it is military. Other parts are political and economic. So I've talked now for almost an hour, and I've laid out what I think we should be doing and why. But I've talked at a level of generality that might not be totally satisfying. So I would like to entertain any specific questions that you have. Syria is free game, as well as anything else. And I understand you're supposed to come up to these microphones. And I think since they're taping this, they want you to partly look that way. Okay. Profile. They want to profile you.
Okay. Well, thank you for your informative and philosophical perspective on all of this. A couple of things that you said struck me as not as well developed as I was hoping to hear. You know, the isolationist policies of the United States prior to World War II almost certainly contributed to the length and devastation of it. So, assuming we don't want to retreat back to the isolationist tendencies, do you believe there's a need for us to spend seven times more on a military than the next largest military operation? This is the first question.
The United States is a global power, right? So if you don't want us to spend so much on defense, then you have to tell me which regions you want us to get out of. And then you have to tell me what your objectives are in the various regions.
Okay.
I've laid out my objectives. I think we can spend less, but eliminating waste, fraud, and abuse is not going to dramatically reduce the defense budget. The only way you reduce the defense budget is reduce force structure. That means the number of men and women you have under arms and all the affiliated equipment. There's no doubt that we're going to do that, and we're going to do less. We're going to do less because we're going to have less. The question is that less enough compared to other countries in the world? I don't want to see the defense budget halved. Can we cut it 20-25%? I think so. I've talked to some of the military, and I said, if you have 20% less, can you still generally do your mission, the key ones? And the answer is yes. So we have to cut the defense budget. Defense has to take its hit like everything else in this country if we're going to get our fiscal house in order. It's a question of how much and in what areas. And we're not going to be able to do everything. My final point that I didn't make as clearly as I should have is that this is not a recipe for the United States to do everything. Other countries have to do more, but as I said earlier, if we don't do our fair share, and since we're the world's strongest and richest country, our fair share means doing more than others. If we're not going to do our fair share, they're sure as hell not going to do it, and then we're not going to end up with the things that are in everybody's interests. So I applaud your question, but I can't think of a better answer.
Okay. So philosophically, you are comfortable with the idea of the U.S. military being 5, 6, or 7 times larger than the next largest military?
That's because other countries are regional powers. We're a global power.
Correct. The last part that I would like to address is you talked about the U.S. military having a 5-year plan and that involving a few cutbacks. It seems like every time we change administrations, all of our budget thoughts go out the window and we start reacting to the tax policies of the ruling party. However, China has a 5-year plan, then a 5-year plan after that, and a 5-year plan after that, and a 5-year plan after that. And all empires fail. You started your conversation with what are you projecting for the next 10 years? I would ask you, what are you projecting for 20 and 50 years down the road? Thank you.
I can't answer that question. I can't look beyond more than a decade or a decade and a half. And the uncertainties with regard to China are so great. China is in an extremely precarious situation right now. And the leadership is running incredibly scared, which is one of the reasons why they're playing the nationalist card. Their banks are technically insolvent. 25 or 30% of their economy are state-owned enterprises, which are extremely inefficient and which absorb all the credit. There's a real credit crunch, and many people argue a real estate bubble. All the smart money and the rich Chinese are taking their money out and buying property in the United States and elsewhere. So there's a huge uncertainty with regard to China. The darn place could implode economically. So I can tell you what it looks like over the next year or two, but projecting China out for 20 or 30 years, I can't do that. The problem with these projections, you can't just do linear projections because things change. So simply projecting out that way. I think I can say with confidence that the United States will have less global freedom of maneuver because other countries will be getting stronger relative to us, even if we're getting absolutely stronger. What counts in international politics is not absolute power, it's relative power. How strong you are relative to others, not how strong you are overall. And I just think that the period of American dominance from the end of World War II until now is a passing era in history. We will still remain the world's most powerful actor. I don't know how long that will go on. But I'm 71, so I can't look out 3 or 4 decades. I'm not going to be here.
Thank you.
Thanks for your talk. I was struck about midway through your talk, you brought in the language of religion when you said, perhaps in passing, that America is blessed to have these two vast oceans and Mexico and Canada are no problem and so on. And I want you to speak directly, if you're a true believer in American exceptionalism, that there's some kind of divine aspect to this on the one hand, and if so, or even if not, if you could discuss some of the exceptionally stupid things America has been doing since the high point of the Cold War, namely the war in Afghanistan, the first one, to oust the godless communists from Russia, which led indirectly and to some extent directly to the formation of Al-Qaeda. The tragic events of 9/11 was the result of an alliance gone sour. And then if you turn to the post 9/11 world, you have Iraq, which you were critical of. I was happy to hear that. But Afghanistan, Guantanamo Bay, Abu Ghraib, a legal framework for torture. Obama was elected. He has doubled down on many of the Bush-era policies, stepping up drone strikes.
I get the impression you're not a cheerleader for American foreign policy.
No, but I wonder if you could address some of those things. And one thing you left out in your rehearsal of the 1990s, I have to say, was, to my mind, the first time that a multilateral proxy was used by America, namely the United Nations, which led to, these are official UN and UNICEF numbers, over 500,000 Iraqi children were killed as a result of the sanctions regime in Iraq that Clinton presided over. So I wonder if you could address that, and if theology might have something to do with some of this nonsense that's been going on for a long time.
I'm not going to stand here and say that the United States has made no mistakes in its foreign policy. That would be stupid. We have done many dumb things. In my view, we did an even larger number of dumb things under George W. But we've also done some good. I don't think I have time to go through each one of them. Let me just finish. I'm not trying to beg off. But let me ask you this question. Who would you rather have the world's most powerful state? What would be your choice? You've got to pick. You cannot not pick. What country looks better than the United States in your view?
Well,
as the world's
I think
most powerful
very
state.
Poor choices, but
well, that's what politics is about.
United States.
Politics
that's
is about poor
sure.
choices.
It would not be the United States.
I understand that. Who would it be? Russia?
I
China?
No.
India?
Uganda? No, but you're putting me in a corner that I don't wish to be.
Well, of course you don't want to be in that corner. Nobody wants to be in that corner.
Right.
Politics is about alternatives. What's your alternative?
Right. But this idea...
Look, I'm admitting your point, sir. I mean, I'm not trying to be combative. I take your point. Your point is well taken. We've done a lot of bad things. We've done a lot of things that a realist would cheer. On the other hand, we have also done a lot of good things. Now, the question is, have we been more of a force for good than a force for evil? Look, we supported during the Cold War a lot of tin pot dictators, right, who also did horrible things to their people.
Yeah, that's a very long list.
But it was better that we won the Cold War, in my view, than the Soviets.
I don't think we won the Cold War. I think we just didn't lose it quite as badly. Because 9/11 and all of the nightmares since then, I think, are directly related are related to the unfinished business.
I think that we are reflecting a polarization that is now going on in the...
Good evening, Professor Art. My question relates to the concerns with China's growing power and threatening America's position as the global superpower. Could you predict that if China decides to make a direct confrontation with the America's actions in Eastern Asia to evict us from being there, that they could increase their GPD by producing more war machines and then also using their population to like actively evict us from the area, thus increasing their power politically and internationally?
How best to answer that? China's goal with regard to East Asia, in my view, is the same as America's position historically, beginning with the Monroe Doctrine in 1823. The United States made clear its aspirations in 1823, although it didn't have the power, to be the regional hegemon in this world. And the Monroe Doctrine basically said, we'll stay out of your problems, your area of the world, you stay out of ours. We didn't have the military capability to do that until the end of the 19th century. And that's when we became the regional hegemon in the new world in the Western Hemisphere. I think that this is what China wants to do. My observation is that as countries increase their power, their appetites increase. And I think it's the ultimate goal of the Chinese to evict the United States as an important military power in East Asia. And our goal is that we're not going to allow them to do that. So then the question is this going to end up in a shooting war? My view is probably not. Why? Because these are two nuclear-armed countries. And nuclear-armed countries tread very carefully vis-a-vis other nuclear-armed countries. So nuclear deterrence does work. Is it the best solution? No, the best solution is to get rid of nuclear weapons. But then to really get rid of nuclear weapons, you have to take all physicists in the world and either perform frontal lobotomies on them or shoot them. Because as long as the knowledge of how to build nuclear weapons is here, you have to worry about the races to rearm, which could be very destabilizing. So I'm fairly confident that the United States and China can manage their rivalry, and there is rivalry. But there are also great chances for cooperation. The two of us, these two countries, produce 40% of the CO2 emissions into the atmosphere. We need to cooperate with one another if we're going to induce other countries to do more. And of course, then we need to do more. So I think we're going to have a mixed relationship with China. And they have goals that are opposed to ours, and we have goals that are opposed to theirs. What else is new in international politics? The interests of states conflict. They don't see things the same way. They're positioned differently. But I don't think that, in my view, this is going to end up in a major war between the United States and China, because nobody wants that because of the fear that things could get out of control. Cuban Missile Crisis, is lessons have been learned. They're even being learned by India and Pakistan. If Iran goes nuclear, they will be learned by Israel and Iran. I'm not advocating the spread of nuclear weapons. I'm simply trying to argue what is the impact of these on great power rivalry. And it's been beneficial, in my view.
Thank you for your time.
Sure. Thank you for your question.
Thank you, Professor. I guess my question, I have many questions, but I actually am a veteran, and I served in Iraq as a Navy hospital corpsman with the Marine Corps.
In Iraq, did you say?
In Iraq, yeah. And I agree with you, Iraq was a huge mistake. But my question is, with the fact that we do have a very powerful military and I feel like during this talk, we've talked a lot about global powers and being able to utilize nuclear weapons as a means of forming protection over other nations. At what point do we have a moral obligation to utilize the military for the prevention, our military for the prevention of genocide, for example, in Rwanda, or at this point in Syria? And will that, does military intervention, it seems that our military has made a lot of mistakes, and is there a time that a way that we can utilize military intervention to actually make a positive difference rather than propping up tyrants of our world, I get, for lack of better terms, like Al-Qaeda?
It's an extremely important question, and thank you for your service to the United States. When I wrote my book, which came out in 2003, I had Rwanda very much in mind, as well as Bosnia and Srebrenica and all of that, and Kosovo. And my view was that intervening in every civil war in the world is impossible, because there's just not enough troops and willingness to do it, and we don't have the wherewithal. Approximately one quarter of civil wars that have occurred since 1990 and even before, 20 to 25%, have experienced mass murder, defined as the killing of 50,000 or more non-combatants within a five-year period. And I said, those are the, if we have to do triage, and if we're going to do military intervention, those that is going with boots on the ground, those are the ones we have to concentrate on. That's where we can do the most good. They're also the hardest to deal with, given the level of killing. And I think it was a major mistake not to go into Rwanda. I think the best expert, Gerard Prunier, who's written a definitive book on the Rwandan intervention, is French. By the way, the Hutus put a contract out on him after he wrote his book, because it was very anti-Hutu. He said that 20,000 American troops could probably have shut that down, because the military was not very good. So I regret that we didn't do that. I regret what's happening in Syria today. On the other hand, our military is really tired, and the American people are, you know, they understand there's a lot to do at home. But I think that there are things we can do between doing nothing and going in with boots on the ground. And I think we have to ask, what are our interests in Syria? And I see four key interests. The one is try to shut down the civil war, if we can. Now, maybe there's a diplomatic solution, but one of our goals should be to stop the murder of innocent civilians. But that's a humanitarian goal. I think that there are three other hard-headed goals that we have. The first is to make certain that bad actors don't get their hands on chemical weapons. So we need to lock down and destroy those chemical weapons, and that's not going to be easy in a civil war. I mean, imagine both parties probably have incentives to kill these inspectors so that they'll be pulled out. If I was Assad, I would, you know, have my operatives go after some of them, and then they'll all be pulled out because they can't be protected. And he's going to say, well, look, I'm sorry, they pulled them out, but we're trying to protect them the best we can. I mean, there's a lot of stuff that we're going to have to get through. But preventing chemical weapons from being seized by bad non-state actors is a key goal. A second key goal, it seems to me, in Syria is to prevent a Taliban land from arising. As I understand it, there are about 100,000 opposition fighters. About 10,000 of them are the extremists, al-Nusra and ISIS and other such groups. The scales have not yet tipped, but according to the most recent times, and all I know, only thing I know is what I read in the New York Times, certain areas are now being seized by ISIS and al-Nusra. Look what we did in Afghanistan to try to evict al-Qaeda. Do we want al-Qaeda set up in the heartland of the Middle East? So I think another goal is to prevent the revolution from being taken over by the extremists, or preventing the extremists from owning parts of Syria from which they can run training camps. This is going to be a real mess for us. The third goal that I think we have is to cut down Iran's influence and stop Syria being a transit point for arms from Iran to Hezbollah. Hezbollah is probably an even scarier group than al-Qaeda in terms of its capabilities. So far, hasn't gone after the United States. Now, what can we do to achieve these three objectives? I think that we have been laggard in not sending military supplies and more training, which we are now apparently doing, to the Syrian, the moderate Syrian forces, the Free Syrian Army, the Free Syrian Army. And as I gather, they've been starved for weapons. I think that the way to shut this war down is to strengthen another side, the other side, strengthen the moderate side. Now people tell me, well, that'll simply lead to a race, an arms race, between the Russians and the Iranians arming their proxies and us arming our proxies. My retort to that is they're already arming our their proxies. Okay? If we want to shut down this war, either the opposition needs to be stronger so they can negotiate from a better position of strength, or they need to be able to defeat Assad, one of the two. I don't think that they're going to give way to allow Assad to remain in power, maybe as a transitional figure. So this doesn't require American boots on the ground. I'm prepared to go one step further if diplomacy doesn't work, if these measures to get rid of chemical weapons do not blossom into a full political settlement, then I'm prepared to go one step further and use American air power to level the playing field and to go after Sadat's artillery and to go after his air force. So this is my view. It doesn't require American boots on the ground. It may require some American forces in Jordan or in Turkey for some protection of logistics and training units. But it doesn't require that we send in an army of 150,000 people. This is a war that has to be fought by the opposition, and they are fighting it. I'm told by a Syrian expert that every young man of your age, between 18 and 25, is now under arms. There's no alternative. And no matter who wins this, it's going to be real messy. It's going to be very messy. Those people hate one another.
Bearing in mind that Al-Qaeda is also becoming an influence in Syria. With the opposition.
That's ISIS.
Yeah.
And Al-Qaeda thrives on this kind of situation. Al-Qaeda in Iraq was practically destroyed. Look at it now. So that's my view of what our interests are, besides the humanitarian interest. We would all like to shut down the war, but I don't want to see 150,000 American troops in Syria. Can we really figure out who are the good and bad guys?
Thank you.
Yeah.
Okay. I just got one short one here. You've been recognized by the Council on Foreign Relations for your work. Have you ever been, or are you a member of the Council on Foreign Relations?
I thought you were going to say Communist Party there for a minute. Yes, I am a member of the Council on Foreign Relations.
I see.
All right, thank you for your thoughts and your research. I wanted to ask, I'm wondering, as many people see, we have a very flawed democracy with extreme economic inequality. I wonder, as people stand up in protest of this economic inequality and this flawed elite corporate security state, I wonder if you see a need for a very significant selective engagement here at home because of our flawed democracy?
That's a question about what are my views towards the inequality of wealth in the United States, and my answer, it's bad for economic growth. For starters, it's also not great in a moral sense. I don't believe everybody should look alike, but the net benefit of, let's just say the upper 1% has been benefiting more than the rest of us. And I think that some economists, I understand, have done some work in analyzing the relationship between economic economic inequality and economic growth. And the greater the former, the less is the latter. I think it's the point Paul Krugman has been making in his column. It seems to me reasonable to me. I think it's gotten way out of hand. I think it hurts the social fabric of a country to see these kinds of inequalities. And particularly since, well, I don't have a high opinion. I hope there are no Wall Street people here, but I don't have a high opinion of Wall Street pundits anyway. They always tell you to buy more. It's because they make money.
So do you see that need for a selective engagement here?
Well, selective engagement is a strategy about how to use military force and for what purposes. I don't want us using that in the United States, besides it's against the law and Constitution. But I resonate with what you say about inequality.
Thank you very much. One more. A great evening. There aren't many of us left here, but we're the real hardcore, you know, foreign policy wonks here. But so you're welcome to go into the lobby, and we have some drinks, and we can. I know there were more questions here, and I cut off these students, and I feel guilty about that. So I know Dr. Art will stay for a little while, and we can chat some more. And I think some of his books are out there, and maybe he'd sell one or two to you. Thank you all very much for coming.